Others see the numbers now. Deshaun Butler, as Mike said, 17, 3 for 5 from three-point territory. Alex Ruoff is 2 for 4. And Jesus Verdejo, just 1 for 6 shooting that rock in the first half. And Verdejo, of course, the second leading scorer on this team. As Chris Howard with the basketball. Howard, as we talked about earlier in the broadcast, battling a flu bug of some sorts. Couldn't practice on Thursday. It's got to be tough.
That's a good point. You know, you got your point guard who's been sick for a couple days. It's the third game of a three-game road trip, and you can almost see it on their faces. You know, they just seem a little bit wore down. We'll see if they can dig deep and find a little bit of energy for the last 20 minutes.
It's interesting as we look at 7 on the shot clock. West Virginia commits the first foul of the second half. Alex Ruoff picks up his first. It's interesting, Mike. You look at Gilchrist, who's on our star watch, coming off the 22-point game.
Nice look.
Nice job there by Dominique Jones. Gets his first bucket of the second half. But Gilchrist, 1 for 1. It's not like he's 1 for 7 or 1 for 8. 1 for 1. What does that say about West Virginia's defense?
Well, great denial, obviously. I mean, Gilchrist is an unselfish player. He's not the type of kid that's going to force shots, and he didn't in the first half. And when you combine some good defense and good denial with an unselfish player, quite often what happens is a kid that doesn't force, it doesn't take a lot. You know, 1 for 1, nice job by Gilchrist staying within himself, but they need some help. It can't just be Dominique Jones.
Last two games, Gilchrist 16 of 23 shooting the basketball. Dominique Jones right now with 15 points. But Gilchrist also 1 for 1, so you talk about that denial defense, but 0 rebounds after Stan Heath challenged him just yesterday. Go back to look at the Star Watch update. Gilchrist, 10 minutes in the first half. Butler with 17 points a minute.
Great job by Butler. Right now, something to look at. Chuck Bryant on the bench in the second half early. Played all 20 minutes in that first half. Saw Bob Huggins talking to him on the way into halftime, and they come out with Ruoff and Butler handing the basketball.
Dominique Jones has picked up his second. You know, 1 point per minute. Yeah, I know you're into that stuff, that per minute stuff.
Well, I like points per possession. I think that's the best way to break down teams and their efficiency. It's hard to compare when you've got some teams that run up and down the floor, play a lot of possession, score a lot of points as a result. They look like they're better offensively, but they may not be. And I think Pitt's the best example. Pitt right now is the best offensive team in the Big East, but they don't score the most points per game because they don't play a lot of possessions.
Last offensive possession, very good teamwork that time by West Virginia. Timeout called for the Bulls, and there's that defense for the Mountaineers. Well, that is frustrating. Now take us out on the floor, Mike. We're going to take a quick break, but I want to have you take us out on the floor. What's it like when you can't even get in your offense? You can't see the basket. You can't get your shot off the back. Louisville warming up, though, Mike.
Absolutely.
I think that's going to change.
Yep, those are conference-only stats, too, by the way. Trying to take out the fact that some teams play tougher non-conference schedules than they do in conference.
Big game in Freedom Hall, Louisville and Pittsburgh tonight. We'll find out about points per possession in that one, no doubt. Dominique Jones trying to take a trip down the lane. Another foul by West Virginia.
You know, I talked about USF being one-dimensional and Jones being the one player that could score in that first half. And yes, you need to add some extra guys to that mix, but how effective is he? I mean, you watch him play, he can score from the outside, and that strength that he has, he's very good with the basketball. When he puts it on the floor, he is so prone to getting fouled that it's actually sort of a good offensive strategy. Put it in his hands, let him create for himself and get fouled or get to the line.
3 fouls by the Mountaineers in the first minute 25 of the second half. Now let's get back to the other thing we're talking about. As a player, take us out on the court. You're trying to run your offense, and the defense is just totally taking you out of it. You can't even get into the passing lanes, and you're about 5, 10, 15 feet beyond of what where you usually start running your offense. What's that like out there, and how do you rectify that?
Well, it's brutal. The only way to take care of it, you've got to be very patient when you put the ball down on the floor. Whenever you catch it, don't just start dribbling right away. That's what gets you in trouble, and then be careful where you pick the ball up. You've got to give yourself a few passing opportunities.
John Flowers. They say since last March, John Flowers may have improved his game as much as anybody on this West Virginia team. You talked about Ruoff, not just an outside shooter, dribbling. Doesn't go inside to the offensive stick back. Deshaun Butler gets, I guess you could call that some garbage points there. He's got 19.
He's so good on the offensive glass. Deshaun Butler, one of those guys. Second chance opportunities.
Another foul by West Virginia. Starting to rock up here, and Bob Huggins is standing over there with his arms stretched out like, what are you doing?
The ref's calling a little tight here early in the second half, trying to clean up some of the hand checking. Butler with a miss and a quick put back.
Last foul against Flowers, that's his third now. Espinoza rejected that time by Ebanks. And I think Espinoza was a little bit surprised at how quickly Ebanks got back over to defend the shot.
Well, everybody loves to talk about length, and that's where length comes in handy. You get burned on the inbounds play and come back to block the shot.
Verdejo, 1-for-6. Last year we did a game down at South Florida. And Verdejo hit this monster three coming off the screen to send it to overtime against UConn, Mike. And he said ever since that game, he's been working diligently on his own game. Didn't even want to go home back to Puerto Rico in the offseason because he feels this team is so close. I mean, they're not going to compete with the UConns and the Pittsburghs and Louisvilles, but they're so close to turning the corner in the Big East Conference.
Well, it's good to hear from your players, especially one of your better players. And Stan, he's such a great guy, such a great coach. I love to watch his teams play. And right now, just undermanned, as you talked about Rick Pitino saying, they've got some great young talent, just trying to add the depth of talent. That'll be the difference maker for them. When they get that, they'll be able to start moving on up in this Big East Conference.
Wow, you see how easy it was for Wellington Smith to get that offensive rebound that time? It was like a pickup game, and it was time to break for lunch, and everybody was breaking down on defense. Nobody around him. Well, golf fans and golf pros, registration for the 2009 ESPN National Golf Challenge is already underway for courses and teams in the Gross, Net, and New 55 and Older Senior Division. For more information, log on to ESPNGolf.com. Golf is just around the corner, but our crew showing up about 5 o'clock this morning, they said it was about -3. A little bit chilly here in Morgantown today, and two powerhouses score.
Dunk over Mike Rosario, Rutgers, was just incredible. I mean, Flynn is an explosive player, knows how to run that team, and he can still score, too, as a point guard.
Got a great point, though, with Fields. 13 assists, one turnover the other night. But Mick Cronin from Cincinnati was telling me that he thinks that Johnny Flynn is mentally the toughest guard out there. He says 40 minutes, he'll guard you with his fist lock, like he's going to get into a little rumble with you.
Yeah, no shortage of talent.
Never tires. So Dominique Jones isn't tired much either. 7 turnovers in the ballgame now for the Mountaineers.
Lots of communication by West Virginia on defense. A lot of switching on all the screens. You got to talk if you're going to do that.
Goes out of bounds, and it's coming back to West Virginia. 8 turnovers now for the Bulls. 38-25. Bob Huggins. Just in his second year. Had a 4 or 5 years down the road, you got to wonder what kind of program this West Virginia program is going to be, considering what he did at Cincinnati and 1 year at Kansas State.
Great point. Already sold more season tickets than they have in the history of the program, over 7,000. A lot of people excited.
Up 13. Butler with the spin, make it 50. As he kisses it off the glass. 21 for him. And one thing West Virginia does well under Huggins is protect the lead. They're 35-2 and leading by 10 or more. And right now they're up by 15.
Yeah, it's just a fun move to watch. A guy like Deshaun Butler at his size being able to put it on the floor, use a great spin move. You just can't defend that.
Well, Dominique Jones trying to carry this team offensively. Last year he had Kentrell Gransbury. This young man, Jesus Verdejo, had stepped up early in the year and finally gets it to go down. So Verdejo, his first bucket in the second half, he has 6. Nice game against DePaul, huh? 18 points, 8 rebounds against DePaul.
He had 6 assists in that game as well. Kind of a nice all-around game. That was a big win for them. It was a tough time in the Big East Conference, winning on the road. That was only their second win all time in the Big East Conference. Road win, that is.
Truck Bryant with that little runner he likes to take down the lane, but hasn't been successful with that. Hasn't gotten it to fall here this afternoon. There's Verdejo again. We'll see if he's starting to warm up. Well, man, it was there, but it wouldn't go down.
You see nobody inside. No green jerseys inside for an offensive rebound either. What makes West Virginia so deadly is not only do they run good offense, have some good scores in Roth and Butler, some of the other guys, but they also get on the offensive glass so well. Taking their time, running some nice screens, taking care of the basketball, making sure they get a good look.
Ruoff found that opening and took it and scored on the left side again.
USF looks tired. They're just a step slow right now defensively.
You know, you talk about the fact that Stan Heath, Rick Pitino likes the core he's building. They're going to be better next year, and in 2 years, even better yet. But Mike Mercer, the Georgia transfer, went out with the ACL. How big of a void does he leave with this bowl team?
Well, that's a big void. They need another score. I mean, obviously, Gilchrist is struggling a little bit, but they could use another one. Mercer was that guy.
19 now for Dominique Jones. But Deshaun Butler, he has 21-2 here as he goes high off the window. And Alex Ruoff, well, his first bucket to the second half is a drive down the lane. He's got in Morgantown. The Mountaineers trying to open up some breathing room now. 42-29 with 14:23 to go in the game. All season long, Champion Apparel will be showcasing the tradition and history of the Big East Conference. And this afternoon, let's take a look back at one of the great players to wear a uniform here in Morgantown, West Virginia, of course, Jerry West. And Mike Kelly, you're probably too young, but as far as the wall factor when you're a young kid growing up, this guy definitely had the wall factor in my life.
Well, you look at the numbers and what he did in 3 years, the all-time leading scorer at this school, and he did in 3 years, and no one's really come close to him. It shows you what a prolific scorer he was.
Well, champion, it's how you play, and there's Jerry West statue outside the Coliseum, and three seasons, a 2,000-point score, led the Mountaineers to the national championship game in 1959, where they fell to Cal, their only appearance ever. Look at, averaged 25 points a game. That's pretty good for
not bad
a career. I think I averaged 25 in pregame one time. And sat the bench the rest of the game.
Keep a little notebook under your chair. Get back, write it down real quick.
No, really, my sophomore season, we used to have competitions for the kids that weren't going to play, and I was one of them. Who could score most in pregame?
Yeah. Talk about that at your reunion. Yeah. Let them know you still got the mark.
I didn't show up for my reunion. I would have gotten that last game, but 10 on the shot clock, and now the defense trying to pick it up on the other side for the Bulls. Stan Heath, what a class guy, though. You were at Pittsburgh. You had some snowstorm going on, and they were 20 minutes late getting to the arena. And what did he say to the bus driver? The bus driver apologized to him.
Yeah, the bus driver apologized profusely and Stan said, "Hey, listen. If this is the worst thing that happens to us in our life, we'll be doing all right." Now, most coaches would be wound so tight being arriving late to a game, and that's just the way Stan Heath is. I joke because my junior year, we went to the Final Four. We were in the Big Ten. We played against Michigan State twice during the year, once in the Big Ten tournament, and then we met them in the Final Four, that great team he coached with Mateen Cleaves and Morris Peterson, and they beat us all four times. So maybe the reason he's so nice to me is because every time he sees me, he's usually winning a game. Brings back good memories for him.
Now we'll see if the Bulls can get that transition game going. Howard doesn't get the bucket, but Deshaun Butler said, "I never touched him," but he's going to be charged with the foul. And Bob Huggins says, "I didn't see him touch him."
I kind of agree. It looked to me like Butler was actually doing a pretty good job of staying away. Let's take another look. Well, I don't see it. Got to disagree.
That's a 16 foul on West Virginia as Howard. This is the first. Chris Howard, 2 points today. Keep in mind, coming off a 12-point, 10 assists, no turnovers against DePaul. 13 points, 3 assists, no turnovers against Pittsburgh in 39 minutes. 7 for 14. Now it's 8 for 15 from the stripe. As Howard now with 3 points. Now, you were talking about Michigan State a second ago, and Stan Heath. Do you see any similarities between those Spartan teams and what he's trying to build at USF?
I see what he's trying to do. I mean, he's trying to run those great sets. He's got a nice point guard in Dominique Jones, but the pieces aren't there just yet to do it. That Michigan State team's so great at getting out in transition, and they don't have the bodies yet to do that. So it'll be a while, but they've got a nice young guard, Crater, coming in from Ohio State. He'll help.
Ebanks, goaltending. So the bucket and the rebound goes to Dominique Jones, and he gets the two. Let's take a look at today's game summary in just a second. That goaltending gives Dominique Jones 21 for the afternoon.
All of a sudden, USF making a little run here. West Virginia slowing down on offense.
Look at Ruoff with a spin inside. Doesn't go. Ebanks had a chance to show off some of that athleticism. Now let's take a look at today's game summary, brought to you by Verizon Wireless.
See Butler there, 21 points, 4 boards, and Dominique Jones, the story for USF.
The goaltending puts him at 21 now, too.
We've seen the last few minutes how USF is trying to extend the defense. I like the call by Stan Heath. Anything to try and jumpstart your team. They were kind of showing the effects of the third game of a 3-game road trip. Their point guard sick. They kind of look lethargic to me coming out of halftime, and I think extending that pressure has kind of woken them up a bit.
Alex Ruoff at the stripe. 38 against Radford, 17 at Ohio State, the same day that the football team beat North Carolina in their bowl game. That was quite the day for West Virginia fans. I mean, what a victory, beating Ohio State by 28. That's the worst non-conference loss in Buckeye history. That had to be sweet for Bob Huggins after all those years he coached at Cincinnati as well.
Yeah, that was the clear out move they'll run. They ran that against Pitt. Bob Huggins even talked about it. The media this week, they run a nice clear out for Dominique Jones. Just let him take it to the basket. Last year, he's a little more perimeter oriented.
Looking inside to Gilchrist, and the whistle. The foul goes against West Virginia before the shot. Is that a concern, Mike? I mean, they've got it 44-32 right now. It's a 12-point game, but they're fouling a lot in the second half. Is that a concern for the head coach, even though he disagrees with some of the calls?
Oh, absolutely a concern. I mean, this West Virginia team.
I don't mean for today, but down the road, as far as the mental makeup.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, listen, they played their last game against Marshall. I think Marshall went to the line like 56 times. I mean, it was a lot of free throws shot in that game. This is a West Virginia team. They're physical. They will foul people. But they've got to be smart about it. You know, we saw that foul. Deshaun Butler trying to avoid it. Picked up a foul anyway. It's those silly ones that I think they have to be careful of.
A little over the back action that time, looking for the offensive rebound that goes against Eladio Espinoza. And if you just joined us on the Big East Game of the Week, it's been all West Virginia, and it's all Ruoff and Butler.
Yeah, great spacing in the half court in the first half. You had Ruoff able to get inside because of the great spacing. He had some three-pointers hit from the corner. Here's Ruoff again with a nice little drive. He's added that dimension to his game. And Deshaun Butler very active on the glass. Active inside, using his great size and speed to create some easy scoring opportunities.
There's a reach on the Bulls. He's against B.J. Daniels, a scholarship quarterback on the football team. The freshman from Tallahassee now playing for Stan Heath and the Bulls. You know, that first half, getting back to the fouls, the Bulls never did get into the bonus in the first half. And then West Virginia, their early foul trouble, 12-41 in the second half. The Bulls already shooting in the bonus. You get back to that Marshall game, you talked about all the fouls. Marshall scored, what, 52, 53 points in the second half? Even though West Virginia did win the game. Inside the Coliseum in Morgantown as the Mountaineers take on the Bulls from the University of South Florida, the Big East Game of the Week. I'm with Mike Kelly, the two-time captain at Wisconsin. I'm Mike Gleason. Augustus Gilchrist just picked up his fourth foul. See, 1-15 all time.
They're not alone.
No,
a lot of teams don't have very impressive records against Bob Huggins.
Huggins with 628 wins. National Coach of the Year, he's the Conference USA Coach of the Decade. This one season, the Big 12 Coach of the Year at Kansas State, and he was the Ohio Valley Coach of the Year. And we saw that video of him playing earlier in the first half. He was the Ohio Player of the Year back in 1972 as Deshaun Butler banks in another deuce.
Well, Mike, how quick is Deshaun Butler getting the ball? When he comes off the score, we saw him in the first half step right into a three. That time, the out-of-bounds play. You got a lot of players who catch it ready to shoot in good position.
So smooth, huh, on the offensive end. Dominique Jones goes in like a bull that time, and Dominique Jones is starting to match him point for point. Both have 23 now. Keep in mind, Butler's career high is 28 he had against Miami this year.
Truck Bryant got his nickname in grade school tournament when he put his head down, just was bowling people over. I think Dominique Jones could be one of those guys, too. He could be Dominique Truck Jones because he puts his head down and gets in that lane in a hurry.
Look at Dominique Jones trying to put this team on his back. Huh? He dishes it. It won't go down. Geez, that should have been an easy basket for Aris Williams that time. Is that a situation where a coach will say to his player, just dunk it? You're
nice look. Absolutely. You're right, Mike. Sorry to talk over you. That was just a great pass. I saw it come open. I wasn't sure if Dominique Jones was going to be able to get it to him. But you're right. Sometimes big fellas, coaches just struggle trying to get a guy to go up strong with it, you know, just authority, and sometimes dunk it or lay it in.
Right in front of the bench, and a Truck Bryant, perfect position to get an earful from his head coach, Bob Huggins, that time. So we're in Morgantown.
Team, they've got all that talent. We've started to see some of that come together, but it's a long season, and there's going to be some adversity. So you have to wonder. And then Connecticut's another one of those teams with just immense talent. But you have to wonder how well they can put it together. If they can do it, of course, any of those teams could win the Big East.
Again, if you have a question or comment about Big East basketball for Mike, email him at kellyscorner@espnplus.com. He'll answer them during the Big East game of the week. For schedule and station listings, go to www.espnplus.com. As the Bulls get back inside, and this time Aris Williams gets it to go down. You know, an interesting question I saw that came down the pipe on the internet was, Mike Kelly, if you had an unlimited budget, which coach anywhere, any coach around the country, which coach would you hire?
Well, I'm curious to see. If you go on the website and check out Kelly's Corner, you'll see that question. I want to hear from the fans. I imagine there'll be some West Virginia fans that would say Bob Huggins is their man.
Well, you have a good argument for Huggins, considering what he's done. But that is a tough question. Anywhere in the country, huh?
Well, anyone in the country, an unlimited budget. If you want someone with some national presence, and Huggins is one of those guys. And the other thing, there's probably some West Virginia fans wondering where their team stacks up. They weren't in the top eight. I see West Virginia fighting with Providence for that ninth spot. I think nine teams for sure get into the NCAA tournament. The question I think will be, is it West Virginia or is it Providence? And we'll see how the season plays out.
Some people say 10 this year, but politically, do you think that's a possibility?
It's possible. I mean, yeah. I think they'll really view every team on their own merits, but given that teams are going to beat up on each other so much,
right.
By the end of the year, there's really only room for nine teams to have that resume that would suggest they should get in.
But you don't really agree with me if I say Louisville's going to pull the upset tonight with Pittsburgh, huh?
I wouldn't disagree with you. No, it's, you know, I think the one thing you can always do is take the home team. Feel pretty good about it. It's a good team, though. They rebound so well. DeJuan Blair, 18-18 is USF last Wednesday.
So Dominique Jones back at the line. Keep in mind, he's got 4 30-point games in his young career. He's got 24 now. Boy, as a freshman, back-to-back 30-point games this year. 36 against Iona, 25 in counting.
The only one to do that back-to-back 30-point games as a freshman was Allen Iverson. That's good company.
Yeah, that goes back, huh?
Love the spacing from West Virginia. Watch them work their offense. Great spacing, nice screens, creating movement.
Ebanks, little ball fake.
Tough shot.
Boy, a lot of arc though on that shot. Probably thank the Bulls defense. Jones, little crossover and the pull up. Knocked out of bounds, and we're coming back the other way. West Virginia basketball.
Well, I like the look from Jones. Getting out in transition, trying to spark his team. Only down eight. Stan Heath likes it too. He's cheering his guys down. I think he can tell. Well, West Virginia was in quite control in that first half. Right now, this is a game that certainly is not over.
Yeah, the rest of the team, not a whole lot of help for Dominique Jones. 9 of 18 and just 6 field goals for the rest of the team. And earlier on the season, he was getting help. Of course, Gilchrist averaging double figures, as is Verdejo. There's another whistle.
Oh, wow, this is going to go on West Virginia.
Wow, largest lead was 17, and now it's down to 8 at 48-40. And Dominique Jones taking the team on his back.
Well, what I like to see about his stat line, 9 of 18, he's shooting 50%. There are a lot of guys that can take over their offense, but here's a guy shooting 50%, a nice look to Verdejo down low, scoring for himself. He's gotten to the free throw line quite well, too. A great size that he has, and now
he's deceptively quick on that first move before he puts the ball on the floor. His numbers 25 points, 7 rebounds. Wellington Smith that just picked up his fourth foul, though, as Aris Williams goes to the line. 28% from the line. Stan Heath was telling me during media day, he says, you know, without Gransbury, now it's time to pick up more rebounding from the guards, and we've got to shoot maybe 70% as a team from the line, and right now they're shooting 59. So that's got to be
not going to get it done. Memphis really struggled last year. Here we go. This game was kind of separating for a while here. All of a sudden, it's a 6-point game. USF doing a nice job defensively, getting some stops and then scoring, more importantly. They struggled in the first half, 0-10 from beyond the arc.
Well, now's the time that Ruoff and Butler get their number called, and they jump in a phone booth and come out and get some instant points here for West Virginia.
Gotta be crisp, make good decisions.
Well, look at Ebanks putting the ball on the floor. Probably a little bit too much dribbling that time.
That's what they worry about. You got to be quick, decisive. They're trying to work Butler and Ruoff off screens, but USF doing a good job chasing around.
9 on the shot clock. 48-42, 8 minutes and 11 seconds to go. Very interesting how the Bulls have scratched their way back in. considering the fact that they have not shot the basketball well here today. Four on the shot clock, three. Ruoff can't get it off, and here come the Bulls. Dominic Jones with the race, the finish.
Oh, wow.
Oh, lost control of the basketball. He knew somebody was coming up behind him. You don't think he was thinking of a dunk there, do you?
Oh, absolutely. I think he was. The ball slipped out of his hands.
Flowers. That's a nice shot for Flowers right there. Didn't go down, but he had a missed opportunity. Let's see if he's going to think of dunking. Oh, wow. 48-40. Getting his teammates involved, but the teammates haven't been much of a help. He's got a score here this afternoon. As Flowers. This is the shot. Another very athletic player shooting only 41% from the free throw line. Knocks down their second. His first point in the second half, and it's 49-42.
Well, I think the question is for USF, can they respond? You know West Virginia at home is going to ratchet up the defense. The ball pressure in the first half got to them. They couldn't run their offense. Can they handle it and get good shots here down the stretch?
Flowers on Jones.
Rodejo.
Open shot. Nice rotation. Ringing up with a three. He's in double figures now with 11 points.
Well, it's a nice offensive set. Most coaches want to get a post touch. They didn't get that, but they did get a nice ball screen. And when there was a little bit of over rotation, Dominique Jones found the open man.
The Bulls 1-for-13 from three, but that cuts it to four. Inside 7 minutes.
You gotta think they want to find Butler, don't you?
Ebanks puts the ball on the floor, doesn't go down. Trying to gain that confidence. You can't complain about the effort, though. He's definitely put the ball on the floor more so today than he did last week against Marquette.
Crowd totally out of it, too.
Inside. Williams, Harris Williams. Nice job, little body hang. He's got six off the bench here.
Now the momentum has totally switched in this game.
49-47. The Bulls cut it to two.
You gotta find a way to get Butler a touch.
Bob Huggins was saying at the end of the non-conference season, we've got some unbelievable mileage out of our rookies, but now we're playing against 22-year-olds. It's time to step up and be men. Deshaun Butler gets the bounce.
There it is. I mean, that's why you got to give him the ball. He is such a good decision maker, along with being a great scorer.
He's got 27 now.
His teammates have to recognize that when they're not scoring some points in back-to-back possessions, they've got to get him the look.
Oh, ring it up, Dominique Jones. 28 now. West Virginia had the 17-point lead at the 2:17 mark of the first half. 51-50 now. Big East basketball
heating up.
It's a battle every day, isn't it? Had some pretty good marquee games on the slate today in the Big East. This one might wind up being the best. But Stan Heath had some interesting things to say, too, about some of these young teams in the Big East. They get it inside, rejected. Ebanks just won't go down now. And finally, the open look won't go. Ebanks with another opportunity. Jones with a left hand.
How many chances is he going to give him? Great job by West Virginia getting on the glass.
Boy, during the next time out, I'd like to see how many opportunities. What, six? Five, six opportunities that time for West Virginia?
Well, I like it. I like to see it out of their players. When you're not hitting your shots, you got to attack the glass.
Dominique Jones waved off. No basket. Verdejo says count it. Tim Higgins says no. The foul before the shot. Stan Heath says no. Give us the bucket.
Look at Stan.
Well, Stan Heath was almost on the ground. He couldn't believe it.
Well, that's continuation in last night's game in the NBA. Here's Jones. A little reach in. Yeah, it looked like he might have been on the way up.
Well, Tim Higgins says no continuation here, guys. Dominique Jones with 28 goes to the stripe.
Mike, you think of all the great rebounding teams in this conference. Cincinnati, a great offensive rebounding team. Pittsburgh, an excellent rebounding team. But West Virginia, kind of undersized. They're the best offensive rebounding team in this league.
A great point to bring up. Plus seven on the glass.
How about the jab step here? Just creating a little bit of space. Remember what I talked about, not putting the ball on the floor too quick? It's exactly what he did there. He got the ball, worked the jab step. That way kept the defender off guard. Didn't know if he was going to drive or shoot. And Dominique Jones doesn't need much space to get the shot off.
Dominique Jones has his fifth career 30-point game now with that free throw. He's got an even 30. Back to one, 53-52. Ruoff takes it the distance right down the lane. The whistle, the foul goes against Aris Williams. You know, Michael, I was saying Stan Heath was bringing up some of these young teams trying to build, the Rutgers, the Cincinnati's, the USF's. He said, you know, the younger teams versus the experienced team, not that West Virginia is one of those experienced teams, but he said you see solid plays down the stretch, not bad plays or necessarily bad turnovers, just good solid defense without defensive breakdowns, quality basketball from the better teams right now. So it's not so much the breakdowns for the younger teams, it's just good quality basketball with the better teams. I thought that was an interesting way to put it. As Ruoff knocks down both.
Absolutely. It's always the little things. Any coach will tell you it's the little things that add up and determine if you're going to win or lose. And those veteran teams seem to do the little things right.
30-second timeout.
Well, Ruoff knocks down both from the stripe, giving West Virginia the lead by three again at 55-52. Timeout. 18 rebound performance. How about Heron Goody, huh? Back-to-back 30-point games. He had 28 then on Monday in a loss to Louisville.
He's amazing.
Boy, geez,
he's got stat sheet stuff for sure.
Nine straight 20-plus scoring games.
We'll 50, clear out.
55-52. Look at the hang time. Gilchrist tries to time it. He's rejected by Flowers.
Shot clock reset. They've got a full 35. Boy, Jones really hung in the air, didn't he, on that drive.
3.5 minutes to go now. USF feeling like they're putting the pieces together to turn a corner, but they have to close out these tight ball games. Last year, they had their share of tight games. For instance, pushing UConn into overtime, but they always came up short. Dominique Jones keeping the Bulls in this game on the road. He's got 30 points.
And he has not come out of this game.
Baseline up. Went out of bounds on the inbounds play. Verdejo hit the black line. Look at the numbers there on rebounding, huh?
32-32. West Virginia, a great rebounding team, especially offensive. There you see the foot out of bounds.
Ninth turnover for the Bulls. They come in averaging about 13.5 for Stan Heath.
Stan Heath just upset. You can't have those empty possessions. If you want to pull out a win on the road, you got to take advantage of every possession.
Down three, and they're not getting any mileage offensively out of Gilchrist. So you really got to hand it to the Bulls for not folding the tents as Ruoff comes off the screen.
Tough shot.
They get another offensive rebound for West Virginia. Ebanks missed it. And this time, Harris Williams says you're not taking it this time.
They fight you for everything.
There's a blocking foul going against Alex Ruoff.
I like that play though. Once again, putting the ball on the floor. I think any time you can put the pressure on the defense, how strong is Jones? You know, he's got that great physique, 6'4", 205, and he's quick, so it's hard to stay in front. If he just gets a half step, a quarter step on you, you end up touching him. And of course, whenever you touch him, it's going to be one of those cases where if you want to stop him, it's going to be a foul.
31 now for Jones. You know, Mike, one of five schools, West Virginia. See, 31-27. Career high for Butler's been 28, as we mentioned.
These guys combined for 58 points. The rest of the teams on both sides combined for 50.
Jones with 32, 55, 54. Clock is ticking.
See if West Virginia can get anything towards the basket.
There's a whistle away from the ball as Bob Huggins wants to talk things over, so he calls another timeout for West Virginia. I was going to say the Mountaineers, one of five schools to reach the Sweet 16, three of the last 4 years. You know everything about basketball. Name me the other four teams.
Oh, boy.
Take a couple of seconds.
Well, thankfully I saw the notes, but I believe it's Villanova, Texas, North Carolina, and Memphis.
Okay. I can't pull anything on you.
Well, I think right now, if you're in that huddle, Bob Huggins, I like this timeout. I want to make sure you get a good look on this possession. Obviously, you know they're going to crash the glass, but I was starting to say before he called it, I like to see them getting something towards the basket, whether it be a cutter inside. We know they run that open post. Not necessarily a guy with his back to the basket, but a cutter or maybe some dribble penetration and a kick out.
But you get the credit to the Bulls for hanging in there. But every time, there's been four times USF has gotten it within one, West Virginia has always answered.
Well, that's what helps playing at home. I mean, they got some good players on their team, and that's life on the road. You can get close, but trying to get over that hump is so difficult.
Well, West Virginia, they won 7 of 8. Then they lost to UConn and Marquette. Back-to-back losses. Bounce back with a win over Marshall. Need the win to go to 2-2 in the Big East here today. Next Thursday, they take on Georgetown. Down in the post, it's Wellington Smith. He's rejected by Eladio Espinoza.
And we got the look inside that I wanted him to get. Just couldn't finish.
Look at Jones. Goes out of bounds. It'll stay with the Bulls. Everybody in this building, there's got to be 13,000 here knowing that Dominique Jones is going to take the shot, maybe.
Well, he just attacks. He just attacks and keeps you on your heels. If he doesn't score, he gets to the free throw line. And once again, I'll say this. The home court for West Virginia, this is very quiet in here right now.
Well, Stan Heath going down at the end of the bench and telling Tim Higgins, give me the timeout, as the Bulls had a tough time inbounding the ball against that tough West Virginia defense.
Every possession so important. Bob Huggins talking to his players about, talking to Wellington Smith about how to score down low. You got to use your pivot foot, son. He was doing a little bit of a pivot back and forth, up and under. Ball fit. Had Cincinnati team number one, but that wasn't in Cincinnati. It was in the Big East.
Now those Bearcat teams just dominated Conference USA. And of course, Wake Forest and Clemson of the ACC trying to stay unbeaten as well.
How about Clemson and Rodney Dangerfield of NCAA basketball right now? Nobody gives them, I mean, I know they're 9 in the country, but 16-0, and you just don't hear a lot of people talking about it.
Well, I guess the average fan remembers Clemson starting in the last couple of years in the same fashion. Gilchrist just fouled out with his fifth, obviously, and he leaves with 2 points after the 22-point effort against Pittsburgh on Wednesday night. Inside, Butler. Flowers, there's a rare three, and he rings it up.
Big three.
Flowers, 15%. Huge three. And Michael, he took it with such ease.
He's wide open. He had to do something with it.
Verdejo doesn't get it to go. We're coming back the other way. The foul's going to go on USF.
Wow, that is probably the worst three possessions you could have for USF. Gilchrist fouls out. They give up a three-point basket to maybe the worst three-point shooter on the team, or at least on the floor. And then they come down and get another foul. Stan Heath has got to wonder what they have to do. They played so well in this second half, but just can't get over that hump.
22 in the last game, 2 points for Gilchrist at 0 rebounds at the break. But how about Flowers, huh? 10 threes last year, just 2 this season, 15%. And you said he had to do it, but what was going through his mind thinking, uh-oh, if I miss this shot, Coach Huggs is... Do I take a step inside
not,
the line?
Hopefully you're not thinking about that when you shoot. Oh, it's not going to go in. That was a nice bucket. I saw the defense actually drop down. They were helping out in the paint. I think content to let him shoot the three. And they knew what the scouting report said. And he beat the scouting report, I guess.
No, Reggie Greenwood and Jeff Clark down
there. They might be looking to see if that was a three-pointer or not.
And Flowers is thinking, come on, guys, it was a three.
Give it to me.
He said 10 threes last year, and Larry Harrison was telling us last week at Marquette, he said, you know, he's a good player, mid-range. He's 4 for 6, 2 for 3 type of player. He was 7 of 8 against Iowa, 5 for 7 against Ole Miss, but they've been telling him, let's just forget about the threes right now.
Well, they're checking to see who should be shooting. Yeah, they got Espinoza. He's going over the back to Ruoff. Here it is again.
Well, that's a tough call. These guys do such a great job. But at this juncture, I guess you could say he was over the back, but not a lot of physical contact on that one.
No, not a ton. That was not the hardest foul you'll see this year in the Big East.
Deshaun Butler. 27 points. Stan Heath trying to turn the corner with this young Bull team. Back to back road games. They saw their share of snow at DePaul They knocked off the Blue Demons at 8 inches in Chicago, I think. They go to Pittsburgh, and they stuck in a snowstorm in the late 20 minutes getting the game, and maybe they needed some snow here in Morgantown.
They played well at Pitt. Only down 4 in that game.
That was Dan saying at breakfast. He said he heard people saying Pitt didn't play that well, but he said, hey, they shot 49%, 55% from three. He said, I thought they played pretty well.
Well, you know, whenever a team, South Florida shot 60% in the first half of that game, and the question is great offense or bad defense. That was actually just great offense. That was not bad defense by Pitt. Rare miss from Ruoff.
Well, the Bulls, here's what, so they go back on a Tuesday to take on DePaul at home, then Villanova next Saturday, the Big East game of the week, and then at Louisville, at St. John's, and back home against Marquette. Ruoff, one of two from the line. He's got 17 now in the ball game, and his team up 59-54.
Big possession for USF.
Jones, spin. A step back doesn't go, but the offensive stick back does, and Aris Williams turns, actually has a smile on his face.
His face. Ruoff doing a nice job staying in front. We talked about him being their best perimeter defender, guarding Jones. He forced him into a tough shot. Here's West Virginia. Here's Flowers again.
59-56. Mike, we go back to that missed layup by Dominique Jones with the ball flipped out of his hand. I wonder if that's going to come into effect here down the stretch. 8 on the shot clock for the Mountaineers. Down to 5 now. Butler and Jones with the ball down 3 with 52 seconds.
Everything on the perimeter that time.
Dominique work. Timeout called. Stan Heath. 42 seconds to go. 25 on the shot clock. Bulls down 3.
Great timeout. I really like it. 42 seconds. Take a look at that miss on the breakaway in case you missed it. Just a little leak out by Jones all by himself. Lost the ball on the way up. That'd be one he'd like to have back. But right now, Stan Heath calls a timeout. It's their last timeout, but I like it. With just over 40 seconds to play. They've got to find a way to get a good look. They don't need a three, of course. The problem is they have Gilchrist out of this game right now, so they lose the one guy, probably their best inside scorer. They don't really have that back to the basket guy, as well as Gilchrist, another guy that can face up and stretch the defense out. I think what they'll probably do is keep it in Jones' hand, try and set a ball screen for him, and then let him create for himself or maybe drive a kick for his teammate.
And keep in mind as we take a look at the game reset there, as far as timeouts, West Virginia still with one to go, both with teams with 10 fouls now. But keep in mind Verdejo, even though he struggled with his shot, he hit that last three. If he's open, he is more than capable.
He can bury it, absolutely. And the other thing to talk about here for West Virginia, at home, we talked about them being maybe the ninth team battling with Providence right now, it looks like, for that ninth spot. And everybody pretty much assumes there's going to be 9 teams in the tournament, in the NCAA tournament from the Big East. This is a game West Virginia needs to win at home against USF. They've got to find a way to pull this out.
Well, I'll tell you, you look at the Big East tournament, too. Everybody's in this year, and Bob Huggins said that's great. As a matter of fact, he was telling you this. I was eavesdropping on your conversation. He said that's great that everybody gets to experience New York City, but that's a long week everybody's in, you know? I mean, then you got the NCAAs hanging there. And
absolutely.
But West Virginia, that'll be Thursday game, ESPN, Georgetown and Pittsburgh.
Wow.
Georgetown and Pitt back-to-back.
Yeah, Louisville and Syracuse. There you go.
And keep in mind, St. John's, too, knocked off Notre Dame this year, so.
All right.
Here we go.
See if Dominique Jones can make it happen.
25 on the shot clock. Jones with 32. Verdejo. 17 on the shot clock. 10 on the shot clock. And there's a steal. Wow, West Virginia really sucked it up on the defensive end.
Got to get a foul here.
19 seconds.
Got to get a foul here.
And there it is right there, Verdejo, or Howard rather, on Ruoff. And so they're going to send a 78% shooter to the line, and they had their opportunity, could not find a shot.
So tip your hat to Ruoff. I mean, that was excellent half-court defense on Dominique Jones. The guy's got 30 points on a night, and he could not get his shot off. They wanted to set a ball screen for him. Ruoff stayed right in front. Verdejo came over for a little bit of help. Great job there, and once Verdejo lost it, I think South Florida lost a little bit of time. Could have fouled a little bit quicker.
It's a big free throw there. Ruoff now with 18 points. And Bob Huggins, we mentioned the fact at the top of the show, he's 18-3 in the Coliseum since coming back to his alma mater. Plus free throw shooting for the Mountaineers down the stretch. 14 seconds to go.
Gotta get something quick.
Jones. Yes, that's a three.
They need a quick foul.
Down two, they're going to foul, and it's going to be Wellington Smith. They're going to the line, this time a 59% shooter. So you go from a 78 to a 59. With still 8.6 seconds to go.
Well, that couldn't happen any better for USF. Quick shot, quick three from Jones. Watch his breakdown. I mean, Ruoff's done a great job, but can't blame him for that one. If you got a guy coming right at you full speed, you want to protect the basket, stay in front. It's just a great shot and a quick foul, and they got, at least it wasn't Ruoff that they fouled too.
And Wellington Smith, the junior from Summit, New Jersey, missing the first one. 2 points, yet to score. No timeouts.
That's right, Stan Heath, about a timeout. Got to communicate.
One of two. His first point of the second half, 62-59.
Mr. Jones, watch for a ball screen, even a driving kick to a teammate.
5 seconds. Jones, there's the three, high arcer. And it's not going to go down. Ruoff chases down the rebound, and West Virginia escapes. The Bulls with 2:12 to go, had the ball. Final chance to take the lead. From 57 seconds to through 20 seconds left in the game, down to the final 8.6. Yeah, chances of tying, they couldn't get it done, Mike.
Well, Mike, great job by USF. That second half, I thought they played as well as they could play to get back into this game. And Dominique Jones, the problem is the defense knows you got to take a three. Ruoff did an excellent job in this possession, staying in front. Unlike the time before, he didn't bite on that fake into the lane, stayed right with Jones and made him force a very high arcing shot. And ultimately, it fell short. Nice job, though, by USF. I thought they played great down the stretch.
Yeah, Dominique Jones with 35 and Deshaun Butler with 27. West Virginia now 2-2, and the Bulls are 1-4. Once again, final score 62-59, West Virginia over USF. A reminder to catch more exciting action. The Big East Network Game of the Week next Saturday as number 22 Villanova takes on South Florida. Then on Sunday, number 20 Louisville squares off against number 8 Syracuse. For more information on ESPN Plus, log on to ESPNplus.com. The preceding has been an exclusive presentation of the Big East Conference and ESPN Regional Television, a worldwide leader in collegiate sports. For Mike Kelly, Mike Gleason saying so long from Morgantown. Enjoy.